In fact, let's just go ahead and read John chapter 3, verses 1 through 21, and then back up and go through them piece by piece like I usually do. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto you, You must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus answered and said unto him, How can these things be? Jesus answered and said unto him, Art thou a master of Israel, and knowest not these things? Verily, verily, I say unto you, we speak that we do know, and testify that we have seen, and you receive not our witness. If I have told you earthly things, and you believe not, how shall you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds might be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. Nicodemus, first of all, in verses 1 through the first part of 2, we see him as a religious leader, but he's coming for truth. He's seeking truth. Jesus said, Seek and you shall find. And this is the right thing to do in any... Look for the truth. Try to get past your prejudice. Try to get past your commitment to things that you should never have been committed to. Try to get past the preoccupation, shrug it off, and dig down for the real, absolute truth. It is there. We live in a day and age today where they're teaching people in college, they're teaching young people that there's no such thing as truth. And in fact, nothing could be farther from the truth. But that is the devil's whole design, isn't it? Yea, hath God said, was the question Satan asked of Eve way back there in the garden. And he's never let up. And he'll ask you, do you really think there is such a thing as truth? Jesus told Pilate, as Pilate questioned him there in the judgment hall, Jesus said to Pilate, everyone that loves truth will come to me. And Pilate, looking right in the face of truth, asked the question, what is truth? And got up and walked away. And you see, there are those that come with this preoccupation, with this preconception, with this prejudice, that the truth can't be known. That somehow it's just outside the realm of understanding. And yet they'll affirm with certainty the theory of evolution as though they do know. Isn't that odd? Well, it's inescapable that we need truth, that we seek truth, that we want truth. But the devil so clouds our mind with all these preconceptions, all these prejudices, and this preoccupation has a tendency by nature to press out and suppress the truth. But Nicodemus here is beginning to open his mind, as I would encourage you to do, and open his heart. And he's seeking for truth. And so he comes to Jesus, but notice he comes under cover of night. Why does Nicodemus want to come during the nighttime? Because in the dark, people can't see you. That's why. Nicodemus wanted to come to Jesus in the nighttime because he feared men. I know this. Look with me at John chapter 12. Nicodemus was afraid of what people would think. What about you and me? Are we afraid of what people would think? You know you are. I am sometimes. I worry about what people think. Then I have to back up and say, wait a minute. If I know that I'm doing right in the eyes of the Lord, if my conscience is clear between myself and my God, if I'm obedient to His Word and I'm not violating His Word in any way, I don't care what people think. I don't care. I can't care. I can't worry about it. I cannot let it influence me. But we're only human, aren't we? I'm only human too. And there are times when it influences me and I sometimes don't act as strongly as I should. These religious rulers, the Pharisees, they had that problem in a big way because they were well committed to their religious system. And it was from their system, which they had established, that they were drawing their living, that they were exercising influence and power. So you can see why, just like our politicians don't want to let go of their globalist agenda. Okay, you can see why these Pharisees also didn't easily want to let go of their religion and were very concerned about what people would think of them. And we see in Luke and John in chapter 12 in verses 42 and 43, it says, "Nevertheless, among the chief rulers also, many believed on Jesus, but because of the Pharisees, they did not confess Him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. For they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God." And folks, I'll tell you, there's a clash taking place every day in your heart right now and every day of your life. There is a battle that's taking place, a clash of wills, a clash of interests, where the kingdom of God and the kingdom of Satan are in direct opposition to one another. The spiritual and the material, often in direct contradiction and battle to one another. That's going on in the heart of Nicodemus. It's going on in your heart. It's going on in the hearts of every man and woman and child on the face of this earth. And there comes a point in time in your life where you have to take a stand, where you have to say, wait a minute, I've got to get to the truth of this. Turn with me to Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8 and verse 38, again we see, For he taught his disciples and said unto them, "The Son of Man is delivered into the hands of men, and they shall kill him, and after that he is killed, he shall rise the third day." But they understood not that saying, and were afraid to ask him. See, that's another problem that we have, isn't it? Sometimes we're just afraid to ask, and we're afraid to pursue the truth because of what we may find out. Again, there's that clash of interests. Friend, I encourage you today to lay aside all preconceived notions. Lay aside commitment to anything in this world and seek only commitment to that which is of God. And seek to understand truth. If we do that, Jesus promised that the Holy Spirit would lead us in all truth. Truth can be known. Truth is right here in black and white in this book. Truth is right there in the person of Jesus Christ. And truth is dwelling within me in the Holy Spirit whom He gave at the moment of my conversion. I can know truth. I can be led by truth. I can walk in truth. And so can you if you'll receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. If you'll come to Him today. Even with a little hesitation as Nicodemus comes. But come to Jesus. His question of Jesus' identity here in verse 2 is more like a statement. Look at what he says to Jesus. "Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God." Is that who you think he is? A teacher? Well, he is a great teacher. In fact, he's the great teacher. No doubt about that. But he's so much more. And Nicodemus is just on the verge of admitting the truth that they see in this man, what they've been looking for. He really, you know, he's like the rich man in Luke chapter 18, verses 17 through 23, who came to Jesus and said, "Good master, what must I do to be saved?" "Good master? You know, there's a lot of folks who say today, Jesus is a good man. But what Nicodemus was really looking for was the kingdom of God. And what he needed to say is, are you the Messiah? Has the kingdom of God arrived? But he was muddled down in this lukewarm, religious, preconceived notion of what they thought Jesus ought to be. And therefore, all he could bring himself to say was, we certainly do think you're a teacher come from God. Well, that's, you know what they use, you know what they say sometimes, close but no cigar. That was definitely Nicodemus' case here. He's close at this point. Maybe by the time the conversation is over, maybe he'll come on in through the door. Jesus said, I am the door. Many today are trying to find a lukewarm middle ground with Jesus, saying that he's just a good man. And I think of a paragraph from C.S. Lewis's compilation of essays called Mere Christianity. And I've read it so many times. But in Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis, he talks about this idea that Jesus is a good man. And he says, you know what? You really don't have that option available to you. He's either the Son of God incarnate, as he claimed to be, or he's a liar, or he's a madman, or he's a charlatan. But certainly, if he's not who he claims to be, if he is not who he presents himself to be in Scripture, as it's recorded for us in Scripture, if he is not the Son of God in the flesh, then you can't say he's a good man, because he's probably a very, 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 very bad man, because he's presenting himself to be the Son of God. But if he isn't, then that doesn't leave good. That doesn't leave good as an option. Jesus didn't intend to leave that as an option. You will either worship him as Lord, or you will reject him as your judge. One of the two. You will either receive him as your Savior, or you will reject him and receive your condemnation. There is no in-between. He didn't mean to leave us that middle ground. And nothing less than a supernatural rebirth, as Jesus responds to Nicodemus in verse 3, it takes nothing less than the supernatural power of God to open our eyes and change our hearts so that we might see Jesus for who he is and enter through that door into the kingdom of God. In verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus, your problem is you're coming to me in your flesh. You're coming to me in a fleshly mind. You're coming to me in a religious mindset. You're coming to me with preconceived notions and ideas. You're coming to me with a worldly ideology. And in that, you are in the darkness. And you cannot see the light. Such is the condition of so many in our world today. Just as Nicodemus misunderstood, so do most people today. Jesus makes this plain statement of the necessity of the rebirth, of the necessity of supernatural intervention to open our eyes and change our hearts that we might enter the kingdom. Jesus plainly states, you can't do it on your own. You've got to come through Jesus Christ. You've got to have the Spirit of God reveal him to you. This is a work. This is a supernatural working of God. But Nicodemus misunderstood. And instead he falls back again on his fleshly knowledge. And he falls back again on his worldly learning. And he says in verse 4, how can a man be born when he is old? Hey, man, you're talking crazy talk here. I don't get you. Where's this coming from? What are you talking about? How can a man be born when he's already been born and he's grown up? And now, here I am, I'm an old man. What am I supposed to do? Can I enter the second time into my mother's womb and be born? Verse 4. The work of the Spirit today is so overlooked by the religious. You know? I'll tell you, we depend so much on our secular education. We depend so much on our seminary education that we oftentimes disregard the importance of the work and illumination and power of the Holy Spirit, the revealing of the Holy Spirit. We need Him. Without Him, we will fail. And what are we seeing in our world today? Why is our country in the shape it's in? We have a failing church. I was listening to Robbie Zacharias recently, and he was quoting a survey that was done by this large company that does these, I forget the name of the company. It wasn't a Christian company. They do these large surveys all the time. They survey thousands of people asking these questions and putting together these answers and coming up with these statistics. And in their survey, they had surveyed pastors of all different denominations. And the question had to do with, do you believe in the authority of Scripture as the inspired, infallible Word of God? That was the question asked to pastors. And did you know that in a few denominations, very mainstream, modern, popular denominations, the answer to the affirmative, the answer of yes, I believe that the Bible is the inspired, infallible Word of God, I believe in the authority of Scripture, the answer from many of these pastors in many of these denominations was as low as, for as far as yes, was as low as 6%. That's saying that in those denominations, and even in the Baptist church, the percentage was low. I forget what exact percentage, but it was way below 50%. The point is that in these churches, we have these pastors standing in the pulpits, and you telling me there's conviction there? You telling me there's power and authority there? There's nothing but what they've been taught in their colleges, what they've been taught in their seminaries, or what. Some of them have business degrees and become, and I've seen them made pastors in certain churches because they had a business degree. Honestly, it's that we're that far gone from reality where the Holy Spirit of God and the preaching and teaching of God's Word is concerned. We're that removed from reality in America today. And that's why the country's in the shape it's in and getting worse. That's why the church is in the decline that it's in. Things have got to change. It's going to take getting back to an understanding that the Spirit of God is necessary for us to have the power and the revelation that we need to know truth and walk in it and have an effect and an impact in our world today. You will receive the Holy Spirit the moment you believe. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. In whom you also trusted, after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In whom also, after that you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. The Holy Spirit that Jesus promised to you came to dwell in you and seal you the day that you believed in Jesus Christ. Romans 8, 9 and 1 Corinthians 12, 13 also say basically the same thing. When you receive Jesus Christ as Savior, you receive the Holy Spirit to indwell in you. And Jesus plainly said in the gospel what the Holy Spirit's job and purpose would be. But to guide us in truth, to illuminate, to empower. You should be imbued with power from on high, he told the disciples. But we shrug that to the side, don't we? In favor of a materialistic worldview. In favor of a preoccupation and a preconceived notion, many times. Like Nicodemus, coming under cover of darkness. We have folks from time to time visit our church. It tickles me. They'll come for various reasons. A lot of times they come because they need help with something. They're going through a crisis. And they know that Faith Assembly will help them. And we will, because we're real Christians. And anyway, they'll come for that. They'll do so, you know, discreetly, and then they're gone. Once they get what they need, you don't see them again until they need something again. We get a lot of that there. You know, that's a shame. But I see what's going on. Most of these folks attend Baptist churches, frankly. And I'm not condemning the Baptist church per se. I'm just saying there's something wrong there. And you see how even today, even in our church, folks come under cover of night because they're afraid of what man thinks. They know where to go. As Nicodemus knew where to go, he knew to come to Jesus and talk to him. But he's afraid of what somebody might think. You know what? To try to understand the spiritual without the Spirit of God is like trying to swim on dry land. Oh, you can give it your best shot. Go for it. Take off or do the backstroke across the floor there, Anna. You won't get very far when you get dirty. It would look kind of foolish. But that's exactly what's going on in churches all over the country today. They're trying to swim on dry land. Because they're disregarding the importance and the necessity for the Spirit of God to reveal truth, to open up our eyes to who Jesus is, what He has done for us, and who we are in Him. Verses 9 through 16, you know, well, let's look at verses 5 through 8, first of all, as Jesus continues to try to help Nicodemus understand the spiritual truth that Jesus is telling him, which Nicodemus cannot understand because he's not coming in the Spirit. Jesus answered in verse 5, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto you, you must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So it is with everyone that is born of the Spirit." There's something unusual about these folks who are born of the Spirit. There's something unusual about these folks who depend on the presence and power of the Holy Spirit to lead into God. There is something very unusual about these folks who exercise the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, there is. You know, they're like that wind that blows about. And the religious mindset can't understand it. They don't understand what we're doing, where we're coming from, where we're going. And Jesus said, that's the way it is with everyone that's born of the Spirit, though. You religious guys can't figure it out. Get off of your preconception. Get off of your preoccupation. Nicodemus answered and said unto him, how can these things be? In verse 9. Nicodemus is still struggling to believe. But Jesus is telling him that his obsession with the prophets, the temple, and the nation are now all fulfilled in the one who is standing right in front of him. But Nicodemus says, what? What? I don't get it. And Jesus says in verse 10, Jesus answered him and said, art thou a master of Israel? And knowest not these things? Verily, verily, I say unto you, we speak that we know. We testify that we have seen, and you receive not our witness. I've told you earthly things, and you believe not. How shall you believe? In other words, Jesus is saying, I've barely scratched the surface here. You know, these are the simple truths you should have been aware of. Nicodemus was a master in the Old Testament law, and he could look in the Old Testament and see that great things happened to the prophet. The prophets prophesied. Great men of God worked valiantly, wrought mighty works and deeds. When? When the Spirit of God came upon them. It's recorded over and over again throughout the Old Testament scriptures. The Spirit of God came upon the prophet, and he prophesied. The Spirit of God came upon Samson. The Spirit of God came upon Gideon. On and on. And they did great things, but they did so by the Spirit of God in faith, believing. And yet here's Nicodemus. I don't get it. And Jesus said, wow, you know, if you can't get these things, what am I going to do with you? How am I going to take you to higher levels? How will you believe if I tell you of heavenly things? No man hath ascended to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Again, Nicodemus, refer to your Old Testament scriptures. The truth is there. But Nicodemus was rooted and grounded in his religious upbringing. He had confidence in the prophets. He had confidence in the temple. He had confidence in his nationality as a Jew, that they were God's chosen people. And yet the fulfillment of all of that, the whole purpose of it all, and the completion of it all, came to being right there in the person of Jesus Christ. Nicodemus was looking straight at the fulfillment of all of which he had struggled to believe in and placed all of his confidence in, and yet he couldn't see him. Many people, listen, the prophets, the temple, the nation, that's where the religious Jews stood. And not wrong, because that's what he had, but what he failed to see was that it was fulfilled in Jesus. Many people today point to a place. As the Jew might have pointed to the temple, so many, Islam, for example, points to Mecca. Oh, that's our place. We go there. You know, you got to make that pilgrimage and so forth. The Hindus, they have the river Ganges. And other religions, they have other things. Or, you know, or they point to their church house or their cathedral. Or they have a certain temple. Every religion has this. And peoples of all kinds throughout the world. But turn with me to Matthew in chapter 12. And see what Jesus said about the temple. See what Jesus said about that special geographical location you might have confidence in. Matthew in chapter 12 and verse 6. But I say unto you that in this place is one greater than the temple. Jesus is greater than the temple. Many folks point to not only a place, but they also point to a person. They may point, as the Jews, they pointed to Moses. Look, Moses, we have Moses. He gave us the law, and that's it, you know. Well, Islam, they point to Muhammad. The Jehovah's Witnesses, they got Charles Russell. The Mormons, they point to Joseph Smith in the Book of Mormon. You know, Buddhists, you know, in India, there you have Buddha. In other countries, they point to Buddha, and he was just a man. And yet the fulfillment of the prophets came, and Jesus said in Matthew in chapter 12, and verse 41, Jesus spoke of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh shall rise up in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, a greater than Jonah is here. So Jesus is greater than the temple, and he's greater than the prophets. And then many people also place confidence in their nationality. As the Jews did, as Nicodemus here no doubt would have said, well, I am a Jew. Therefore, I am a son of Abraham. You remember, John the Baptist told him, don't tell me that you are children of Abraham, for God is able to raise up from these rocks children unto Abraham. Bring me fruits of repentance, John the Baptist demanded. And here Nicodemus is standing before the fulfillment of all of which he believed, and yet unable to see him, Nicodemus says, well, I am a Jew. I am one of God's chosen people. I am a son of Abraham. And others today, it's no different. They believe in their government to be the answer. But Jesus also trumps that. Matthew chapter 12 and verse 42. Jesus said, the queen of the south shall rise up in the judgment with this generation and shall condemn it. For she came from the uttermost part of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon. And behold, a greater than Solomon is here. Listen, friends, your religion cannot do it. No man, no matter how good a man he is, walking the face of the earth, can give you that which your soul needs and thirsts for. And no government, no ideology, no nationality, no politician on the face of the earth can give you that which only Jesus can provide, the salvation of your soul and that living water for which your soul is thirsting, even the Spirit of God. Verse 16, John chapter 3, says very plainly, the only begotten Son of God is the only one who can do what no other could do. Whether it be religion, whether it be places, whether it be people or ideologies, no one else but Jesus can pay the penalty for sin and make us free from the power of sin. Because why? Because God is love. Verse 16, the verse that we all know by heart, memorized it when we was wee little children, no doubt, and most of us have. For God so loved the world, John 3:16, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus is for us salvation and not condemnation. Jesus isn't standing here condemning Nicodemus, even though Nicodemus has come to him under cover of night because he fears man, because he loves the praise of man more than the praise of God. But Jesus isn't condemning him. Jesus is pointing out to him that he can be saved from that. And so in verse 17, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Jesus didn't come to condemn the world. He doesn't condemn you today where you're at. Friend, here's the problem. Look with me at verse 18. He that believeth on him is not condemned. Do you want to be freed from condemnation? Believe on Jesus. But, look at verse 18. But he that believeth not is condemned already. See, there's the thing. Without Jesus, you're already condemned. He didn't come to condemn you. He came to save you. The condemnation already dwells upon you without Jesus. And if you refuse to believe in him and accept him today, for who he is, the Son of God, the Creator of the universe incarnate, the Savior of the world, the one and only, the Messiah. If you refuse to believe that today, then you're already lying in wickedness and you're already condemned. Turn with me to 1 John chapter 5 and verses 19 through 20. And we know that we are of God. We who are saved are of God. We've been born by the Spirit. We've been born again. We're a new creation in Christ Jesus. We're of God. And the whole world lieth in wickedness. Again, this is the Apostle John to the church. Now look, we know the world lieth in wickedness. That's where you were before you met Jesus, but now you're of God. And we know that the Son of God is come and hath given us an understanding that we may know him that is true, and we are in him that is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. This is the true God and eternal life. Oh, little children, keep yourselves from idols. Amen. He closes out his letter. The world lieth in wickedness. Jesus didn't have to condemn it. The condemnation is already there. The whole world lieth. You're born in wickedness. The Bible says you're born in sin. So because all have sinned and are sinners living in wickedness, Jesus came to save. 1 Timothy 1:5 says that Jesus came to save lost sinners. Verses 19 through 21, Jesus explains, look, the light has come. The whole world lieth in darkness, in wickedness. There's a darkness that has the world shrouded, keeping them from seeing truth. But a light has come and shined. Verses 19 through 20. This is the condemnation. Not that Jesus has come to condemn the world. The world was already condemned. Why? Because light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds are evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, neither cometh to the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that doeth truth cometh to the light, that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. Those who want to do evil and want to live a lie, they'll avoid Jesus. They'll relegate Jesus to some chapter of history that says, well, yes, he existed. And the fact of Jesus' existence, by the way, is a well-established historical fact. No one who's serious, no serious scholar, would ever say that Jesus is a myth, that he didn't actually exist. The fact of his existence and the fact that people believed him to be the Messiah, the fact that he worked miracles and so forth, this is all well-established historically. No one of a serious nature, a serious scholar, would ever deny that. Only tricksters, only liars would deny it. But anyway, they'll still reject Jesus and try to relegate him to that chapter of history that says, well, he was a good man, he was a moral teacher and all that, but, you know, he wasn't the Son of God. He's not the Savior of the world. Why? Because they don't want their evil lifestyle reproved or rebuked. That's why. That's what Jesus is saying here. He says men love darkness rather than light. Wicked people hide the light of truth in the darkness of lies and half-truth and twisted words. But those who want to do right, those who want to live according to truth, they'll come to Jesus and they'll come to the Word of God. And that's exactly what Jesus is saying here. But he that doeth truth, in verse 21, cometh to the light, that his deeds may be manifest, that they are wrought in God. What, anybody who cares about doing right, they're going to say things that are unpopular, and you're going to have the Nicodemuses of the media saying, what are you talking about? That doesn't make any sense. Oh, you're living in your own little world. Oh, you're so strange. Oh, whatever, you know. And just like Nicodemus did with Jesus here, you have all these Nicodemuses in the media. They're doing the same thing today to try to shut out the light of truth. But Jesus said those who do truth, they won't be shut out. They'll keep coming. They'll keep coming forward with it. John chapter 18 and verse 37. Pilate therefore said unto him, art thou a king then? Jesus answered, thou sayest that I am a king. To this end I was born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. What is that dividing line then? Jesus plainly said it. Those who love truth